So anyone who today does not pay attention to the Qur'an shall be raised blind on Judgment Day. Remember previously I said that the Qur'an is the light. To follow the light that was being, that has been sent by Allah to us humans. In this life, anyone who doesn't follow this light today does not deserve the eyes to follow the light on Judgment Day. If you do not charge yourself in this life with the light of the Qur'an, just like a drained battery does when you put it, when you charge it, then on Judgment Day you won't need those eyes to see, because you won't have no lights at all. After all, don't we Muslims, when we talk to non-Muslims or to other people from other denominational religions, don't we tell them that the Qur'an, there is no doubt in it, is a book from Allah? At Surah Al-Baqarah, ironically, doesn't it say, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ? That book or the collection of laws, that is the Qur'an, there is no suspicion or pre-doubt about it, is a guidance to piety seekers. And this is Surah Al-Baqarah, number 2. And this is ayah number 2. It's a guidance to the muttaqeen, the believers. You want guidance? Follow the Qur'an. My sister, fast Ramadan in your menstruation. Pray your salat in your menstruation. And alhamdulillah, we have advanced in technology. Women today, when they have their menses, they can wear some cups and some things. And the blood is something of the past. The strange thing about this is that we claim to follow the Qur'an and we're the first one to ignore Al-Qur'an. Subhanallah, I don't know. The Qur'an has become the weakest link in Islam. Hadith is, the Sunnah is authentic, sayings of scholars is, the weakest point is Ma'mar, and the other name is Al-Qur'an. You see, it's unbelievable. Allah's speech has become weak. It's giving me a headache just thinking about it. In Ramadan, when Allah introduced to us Ramadan, what did He say? What did He say? He said, "شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن." Ramadan is the month in which the Quran was revealed. He did not say "شهر رمضان شهر الصيام." Allah did not introduce to us Ramadan as the month of fast. He introduced to us Ramadan as the month where the Qur'an was revealed. And it's unbelievable. And the Qur'an has got many clear proofs, clear evidences. It's the criterion by which you see the day and night. It's the criterion that see right or wrong. If you walk into a big room, hall that is totally dark, and you've got glasses and you've got tables, you've got everything, what is the first thing you run for? Isn't it a torch or a lighter or some form of light so that you can see where you are putting your feet so that you don't hurt yourself? The Qur'an is the light of this life. This life without the Qur'an is darkness. This life without the Qur'an is a man marrying his daughter, is a woman marrying her son, is people killing. Go see the drug cartel, how they kill humans. Go see how they, oh God, it's my brain is going to explode. Look what Allah says to us again. He goes, "Ya ayyuhan nas," and pay attention. Allah is talking to mankind as a whole, you and me included. He goes, "Ya ayyuhan nas, qad ja'akum burhanun min rabbikum." People, a clear proof, a clear evidence has come to you from your Lord. What do you think is he talking about? Al-Bukhari? He's talking about Al-Quran. And then Allah says, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ نُورًا مُبِينًا. And we have sent down to you an evident light. And this is in Surah An-Nisa, Surah number 4, the ayah 174. Pay attention. It's again Allah talking to an-nas, mankind, both male and female. The Quran is the only proof to anything we believe in and do. If the hadith was part of Islam, then we have been betrayed and bluffed by Allah for not telling us explicitly that the hadith is part of Islam. Why did he, Allah says that the religion was completed in Hajj when there was no hadith, not even a single hadith written. All of it was Quran. And Allah told us that the Islam is complete and he has bestowed upon us his favor and he's happy for us that the Islam at that time is the religion he wants us to stay in. Why is it? It's because of the Quran. What more can Allah says to us? هذا بيان للناس. This Quran is a clarifier, i.e. it makes everything clear for mankind. وَهُدًا and a guidance, وَمَوَعِظَةٌ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ and a forewarning for the pious. And this is again Surah Ali Imran, that is Surah number 3, and the ayah 138. In another one, in Surah Al-Isra 17, Allah says, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَى. This Qur'an certainly guides to the most upright way. After you have, you see, when you are looking for insurance for your car, you look at 10, 20, and then one of them will jump out as the best of them all. Well, this Qur'an, it guides you to the most upright way that Allah accepts and rewards greatly for. And then this Qur'an, وَيُبَشِّرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ and gives good news to the believers. الَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ الصَّالِحَاتِ those who do good deeds, أَنَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا كَبِيرًا that they have great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah, with all this ayat, with all this clear, precise and compelling text from the Qur'an, some people in the past decided that the Qur'an by itself is not enough. Allah says it is, and they say it is not. And guess what we did? We believed them, and we didn't believe what Allah says. And for this, whenever you mention Allah alone, people become annoyed with you. These are Muslims, especially Salafists. And Allah has spoken about this behavior, but He spoke about it about people that really don't believe in Allah. Not only that, they are arrogant and deliberately refuse to believe in Allah. And they are the kuffar, and I don't talk about the Jews and Christians. I mean about people who know that Allah should be worshipped, but they deliberately refuse that concept. Allah says, وَإِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ and whenever Allah alone is mentioned, the Quran alone is mentioned, اشْمَأَزَّتْ قُلُوبُ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ the hearts of those who do not believe in the hereafter contract with bitterness. وَإِذَا ذُكِرَ الَّذِينَ مِن دُونِهِ but when others away from Allah are mentioned, hadith, Bukhari, statement of scholars and things like that, and of course, obviously other people, if you say Allah gave us rain, they don't like it, but if you say clouds, physics and things like that, they like it. So that's that. But that is the kuffar, and I'm talking about us Muslims. We share the same behavior. Maybe we are applying it in different fields, but the behavior is the same. Whenever Allah alone is mentioned, we're not happy. But if others than Allah are mentioned, we're happy. That's the behavior. When they apply it in belief in Allah, they are kuffar. But when you apply it about the Quran, guess what? We're not far off from them. But إِذَا ذُكِرَ الَّذِينَ مِن دُونِي but when others for other than Allah are mentioned, إِذَا هُمْ يَسْتَبْشِرُونَ then they are filled with happy joy and they believe you. Subhanallah. And my sisters and my brothers, when Allah wants to punish somebody who has deliberately disobeyed Allah, how does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punish them? By making them not understand hadith? Absolutely not. Look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. وَجَعَلْنَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ أَكِنَّةً أَنْ يَفْقَهُ and we placed a covering on their hearts so they do not comprehend it. And it's talking about Al-Quran. وَفِي آذَانِهِمْ وَقْرَىٰ and in their ears a heaviness. They can't listen it. It's like you know, some people, they like some types of music. If you put them to listen to some other types or whatever, it's like you pour in some hot oil in their ears. They hate it. Okay? وَإِذَا ذَكَرْتَ رَبَّكَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ وَحْدَهُ and when you mention your Lord alone in the Quran, وَلَّوْ عَلَىٰ أَدْبَارِهِمْ نُفُورًا they would turn their backs in despise and run away from you. To close my talk here about the menstruation, and then I will cover the zakat briefly, I will say this. A woman that doesn't fast in Ramadan, ليس هناك دليل قوي من القرآن ولا السنة. There is no evidence, strong or weak or whatever, it's not in the Quran, it's not in the Sunnah, that makes it haram on a woman not to fast when she has her menses, or that she gives birth, or whatever. When she gives birth, if she cannot pray standing, then she prays sitting. If she can't pray sitting, she prays standing. Yeah, subhanallah. If Allah, and I cover this more in Salat, if Allah did not exempt people from a Salat in a state of fight, what is more dangerous? A warrior in a war that is fighting, planes bombing and the enemies and killings and all that kind of stuff, and Allah tells us to pray. Even if we don't have time for wudu, we use the dust, and you can fight and shoot, you can fight and do whatever, but you gotta pray when you do that. And a woman spends a week doesn't pray. That's why they wanted to make to keep the woman stupid, retarded. They invented this lie, and the only evidence for a woman not to fast in Ramadan, or not to pray for that matter when menstruating, is just something the people of the past agreed upon. فَالْإِجْمَعَ فَقَطَ وَالدَّلِيلِ. And there is no consensus. Not, they didn't even agree. And then they tell you, اجتماعوا, and when the Muslim Ummah agree on something, that becomes Islam. I'm sorry. The only Islam on earth is what comes from Al-Quran. And on this, my sisters, I will tell you, my talk here has come to an end. Had I known way before time, with this, my wife and my daughters would have prayed in their menstruation, but sadly I was, as I said then, back then, a Wahhabi Salafist, and I preached that women should not, just like a donkey, just like a parrot, call me whatever you call, I deserve all the titles, and I pray to Allah to forgive me for all those teachings I did. But it was our teachers that came from Saudi Arabia, the university teachers, we trusted them. You see, we used to organize these, what they teach, what they taught at the university in 1 year. We split it in a year into four, every 3 months or every 4 months, depending on the schedule. They would come to Al-Muntada Al-Islami, and then we would hold intensive classes for curriculums that they would teach in a whole year. We take them in those 4 weeks, whatever, with exams and all that kind of stuff. And they promised us certificates, but again, Saudis, when did they keep their promises? And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive that overlooking, and Amin Ya Rabbil Alameen. Now, this is what I have to say about all the menstruation, and as I said, I will cover the Salat in more details, but you hear this, now it's the onus is on you, and I pray to Allah that you will start fasting and praying your Salat, even if you have your menses, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't hold you responsible for doing that, because in the Quran, He has not exempted you. On Judgment Day, you cannot use any other argument apart from what is in the Quran already. Now, for the zakat payment, this is again another big huge headache that every year people ask, and you get into this math calculation, the nisab, what is a nisab, how much should I pay, what is the price of gold, is it on gold that I should pay, is it on silver I should, how about if someone has got the businesses. Imagine if a rich person on earth want to pay zakat on the wealth they have, and imagine this person has got fields of oil, and they have crops, and they have factories to make cars, and they have planes, and they have bonds, and they have shares, and they have wealth, and they have buildings, and they have, oh God, you name it. How are they going to know all this, and how are they going to pay zakat? Did Allah say something in a zakat? Well, here is the good news. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defined that al-anfal or al-ghanima in a war, when you go to war and you fight, actually there is blood and killings and things like that, the war ends and you take the spoils, fifth of it goes back to the government, so to speak, and the other parts, the other four-fifths, goes to distribution to people. When you go to war, but there is no fight, and Allah bestows upon you, as I explained, it is the messenger or the leader that distributes it, as Allah back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Ulil Qurba, and then the poor and the needy and the wayfarers. Now, for zakat, since the first time Al-Quran graced earth, always Allah says, Atau zakat, Atau zakat, Atau, always give zakat, give zakat. But Allah never ever set a percentage or how much you pay of a zakat. And the reason why He didn't say that, because there is no percentage, absolutely no percentage at all. So you're going to say, how do I calculate zakat? Well, you don't have to calculate zakat. This is what you do. Each of us humans has got money. Now, when you donate money, let's say you've got £100 in the bank, and they say, according to how the the righteous predecessors Islam, is that £100 stay with you for a whole year, you don't touch it, and then if you don't use it for a while, it means you don't need it, then you pay 2.5% of it, and then you get this £2.50, and that's it, that's the zakat. Really? Now, let me ask you a question. How much did you feel the impact of your donation? £2.50. No big deal. Somebody has a million and they donate 25,000 or something like that. Okay? What's the big deal? No big deal. But what Allah wants, the secret is in the name of the act itself. As zakat comes from zakah. Zakah, it means alleviate. Elevate meaning gain in prestige, elevate, become a better person, become better. So Allah is telling you, donate of your wealth the amount that you feel when you donate it. It makes you raise closer to Allah. It makes you feel good about yourself. Makes you feel good as a believer. So if I have £100 now, I go back to that £100, and the year goes by, and this year we don't touch it. It's nonsense. It's just a statement of the scholars to define which wealth you should give. Allah, ومن أموالهم ينفقون, is from your wealth, what Allah gives you, you spend. Let's say you want to donate zakat, and zakat can be donated at any one time, not only once a year. You can donate it 600 times a year. You don't need once or twice. You donate as you will. So, for example, I have £100 and I'm walking the street, and then I take and I say to myself, £10, oh, I don't feel big deal. But if I donate £40 out of that £100 or $100, because universal currency, if I have $100 and I'm walking down the street, if I give $10 of it, no big deal. I will just ration it. It's just like having a McDonald's, no big deal. But if I donated $35 of the $100, I will start feeling the punch, the pressure of that money. But if I donate $45 or $50, half of it, and once I donated, I kind of like feeling good about myself. Do you know why it raises you to where? Well, when you are on earth, you fully rely on wealth. So as long as you have money, you feel secure, you feel everything. But that reliance on wealth, Allah doesn't want you to rely on wealth and wants you to rely on Him. So now, when you take the money out of yourself, and you've worked hard to earn that money, but you donate it to people, then you have created a state of neediness in you. And then you turn to Allah and ask of Him more of that gift, of that bounty. That is the zakat. I.e., you have raised yourself from the earth which you are clinging on to with your wealth to the lightness of the heavens, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that He helps you. That's what zakat is. I.e., you raise. If I say to yourself, uzakki nafsi, i.e., I blow my own trumpet, I speak good about myself, I praise myself, right? But instead of doing it in words, Allah wants you to do it in money, clothing. If you have 3 houses, donate 1 house as zakat. Raise yourself. So that's why zakat is not a business deal you hold with Allah. Zakat, it's more for me and you, for you to raise your status by creating a stronger bond between you and Allah. I.e., ya Allah, you donate, and I donate to people so that there is always that neediness between you and me. This is why messengers and prophets, most of them, die without any wealth, because they were always after getting high and high with Allah. And how they did that? Well, by donating money. You see, in this life, you can get high in 2 ways. Take drugs, and then it ruins your life, or donate your money. Spend your money in a manner that raises you high. And that way, that act of you donating money makes you the best people. Because you see, imagine, today, right now, if you have £100, I tell you, give £60 of it. Watch how your heart. That's why Shaitan in Al-Quran ya'idkum al-faqr. Shaitan comes to us and promises to us poverty. You donate, you're going to get poor. So when you withhold money, you have not raised yourself. You have not made zakat for yourself. You have not praised. You have not taken yourself higher. You actually become ثَقَلْتُمْ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ. That's why in another ayah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says ثَقَلْتُمْ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ, you became heavy to earth, because the wealth makes us heavy and closer to earth. But when you donate money, you raise yourself, you get closer to the heavens, you get closer to the skies, you get beautifully up there. So zakat is not 2.5% on what you don't need. That's not zakat. I am 100% sure that this idea of zakat was divided so that the kings and the governors and all these high princes and all these people at the time, the 3rd century, wouldn't pay a lot of the wealth they have. They ended up 2.5%, and it's in our books of history. Told you everything we do according to politics, and I am not wrong, and I am not joking when I say that the Islam we practice today is a parallel Islam to the Quran. It's not the Islam that Rasulullah ﷺ practiced. Now, in closing thoughts again, I want to say something about this beautiful Quran so that nobody ever is going to bring that issue. How do you know the tashahud, and how do you know Eid al-Fitr, and how Eid al-Adha, Janaza? All these things that they mention are school of thoughts, are invented by men of religion. They are not part of an Islam. But a lot of these people, Salafis especially, do not know of the impact of history on this thing. Otherwise, Allah has not been honest with us, and this is impossible, especially when the eternal words of Allah say the following: kitabun, i.e. a compilation, the book, perfectly authored by Allah. Kitabun uhkimat ayatuhum. The hikmah, it's full of hikmah. It's so divinely well authored. It does not have the slightest billions upon billions of percentages of margin errors. Nothing at all. Then Allah says, thumma, then, fussilat, i.e. this ayat, this whatever you read in the Quran, they have been perfectly detailed and explained by the all-wise, all-expert. And this is in Surah Hud, the Surah number 11, the beginning of the Quran. I will say it again. The Quran is a book perfectly authored by Allah to serve, help, support, encourage, strengthen humanity until the end of time. This Quran is also fully explained and fully detailed by the all-wise. The righteous predecessors cannot be wiser than Allah. The messenger cannot be wiser than Allah. He lived a period of time, then he died. That's it. The messenger of Allah is of no use to us today. That's why he's dead. But the other messenger of Allah, the Quran, is fully usable to us, and that's what I am calling you on today. As such, my sisters and my brothers, especially the ladies, when the man says, imagine the beauty of Islam, Ramadan comes in, the man says, come and you carry on fasting. You don't have to worry anymore about, I haven't made up my days, what can I do? Now you understand this more, and you live the easiness of Islam. In year 9 and 10, a lot of tribes, the Arabs in the peninsula, the Arabian peninsula, when they saw that the messenger of Islam, our Prophet ﷺ, became strong, and that a lot of people embraced Islam, many people, especially those special people, the honorable people, came to Al-Madinah to meet Rasulullah ﷺ, and they had in mind, if he was a prophet, then we would follow him, and if he was a king, we would ally with him, and so on and so forth. And if he was a rich man, we'd do business with him. So for all this time, they didn't know, or they didn't hear properly about Rasulullah. So they came to Al-Madina, but they came at a very awkward time. They came around noon when everybody was at home, especially the desert is hot and everything, and they started calling Rasulullah. They would call him, Ya Muhammad, come out to us. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala educated them properly. And this is apparent in Surah Al-Hujurat. Al-Hujurat are the rooms where the wives of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam lived. And the surah is called because of this incident. It's surah number 49. But something in that surah, because the whole surah is in Al-Madinah and towards the end of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's life, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala taught the Arab a valuable lesson. Because the Arabs, when they came, they started flexing their muscles on Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam about what Al-Islam should be and what it shouldn't be. And because they were thinking of themselves as big shots, you know, like we are dignitaries and kings and all that stuff, they thought they would have a special space or place with the messenger in Islam. And they started boosting that we have armies behind us and all that kind of stuff. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught them a lesson because they were looking for a bargain from the messenger. So Allah answers them back saying, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. So Allah here is going to define the believers to them, because these people, they say we are believers. Allah says, no, you are not believers, you just embraced Islam. So the true believers are those الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, those who have believed in Allah and His messenger. And again, when the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was alive, he was the messenger. But now that he is dead, the messenger of Allah to us is the Qur'an. Okay, just like when someone sends you a message on WhatsApp, you say, I received a message. Okay, the WhatsApp is just the tool that delivered the message to you. But anyhow, and then Allah says, ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا, and then they do not, or they did not doubt their belief in Allah and in the messenger, وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, and then they strove, or they strived with their properties and their lives for the sake of Allah. And then Allah says, those are هُمُ الصَّادِقُونَ, those who spoke the truth. And then this is the lesson for you and for me. Listen very carefully to what Allah says about this religion of Al-Islam. He says, قُلْ أَتُعَلِّمُونَ اللَّهَ بِدِينِكُمْ. Tell them, Muhammad, do you really teach Allah about your religion? And Allah يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ, and Allah knows all that is in heaven and on earth. And then he says, وَاللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٍ, and Allah is ever-knowing of all things. Meaning, you just came and you start giving arguments and thinking that this would be good and that would be good, and the messenger of Allah, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, did not have any authority to respond to them, no, you can't do this, because it just delivers. And then Allah tells Rasulullah, tell them, do you teach Allah about your religion? So for these people that have invented this idea that women should not fast when they have their menstruation, they should not pray, where did they get that? From the Qur'an, they will say, absolutely, they will say, not. It's not from the Qur'an, it's from a hadith. Then we tell them, are you going to teach Allah about this religion? It is Him who revealed it. And if He wanted women not to fast and not to pray when they are fasting, guess what? When they have their menstruation, then He would have simply said it in this beautiful Qur'an. This is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanif, and I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us all cling on to the Quran so that it leads us to light on judgment day, so that on judgment day we don't raise from the dead blind, not knowing where to go, when actually we will need our eyes on that day to know where we're going. As it is on judgment day, it already is extremely dark, except a light that Allah is going to give us, and that light is the light you collect today from the Quran. You will find it in front of you on judgment day. So if you don't have the light of Allah in your life these days, the Quran, you won't have that light, the shining light on judgment day. Again, remember, there is no strong or weak whatever evidences direct from the glorious Quran or the authentic Sunnah. And I'm going here the way of the Sunnah here just for argument's sake. Otherwise, for me, what's in the Quran is absolutely fine. I don't need anything out of it. And with time, inshallah, when I cover, inshallah, the science of hadith and especially salat and how the history of Salat, you're going to learn a lot, and you're going to understand that the Salat is far easier than you have been made to believe, and so is fasting, and so is zakat. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.